Hi, I'm Benton Stokes.
And I'm Elaine O'Rourke.
And this is Cocktail Theology. Well, here we are again.
What?
I know. And we're drinking. Imagine that.
Well, you are drinking. Okay, I'm lying. I started to say I haven't had a sip of this, but in fact I have. And it's quite tasty. What is it?
It is. So it's from our Cocktail Theology cocktail book. The cocktail is called The Smoldering Orange.
Ooh.
I know. So it is a bourbon-based cocktail. We're using Bullet, which is one of our favorite bourbons. So good. It has that yummy French triple sec that I can't ever remember the name of.
So good.
Yeah. It has that in there. And then it has Dolin Rouge sweet vermouth. It also has the juice of an orange. It has an Luxardo cherry. And for the smoldering part, it has a generous dash of smoked chili bitters.
I think the only thing I would do differently next time is might torch some orange peel and throw that in.
I think we might have done that the last time we made this.
I think we did it with tangerine skins. I think we torched tangerine skins. And I might, instead of using... Well, I don't know. The juice of the orange is so tasty. But it'd be nice to have something else to cut down the sweet just a tad for my taste.
Yeah, agreed. So today's episode was your title. So I'm going to let you do the opening explanation about what we're talking about today.
Okay. So if you go back to our first season and you look at those titles, those are mine. They are incomprehensible. They allude well to what we talked about. But really, no one is inside my mind deep enough to know what the heck I'm talking about, okay? So this one is not as incomprehensible, but it is somewhat misleading.
Okay.
So I'd like to make an apology before we start to any of our listeners who are Anabaptists in the European Anabaptist, primarily Swiss tradition. If you are, in fact, an Anabaptist of that sort, you are... a Protestant. However, if you're almost any other kind of Baptist, you're not.
You're not.
Okay, I think we're done. No. So here's... There's so many reasons I wanted to just play with this today. I think in the United States, and this may be true other places, but here, we have the sense there are Catholics and there are Protestants.
Right.
And that there is no real distinction in the Protestants except on the basis of whether they're quote-unquote Bible-believing or quote-unquote liberal or whatever.
Yeah.
That's the distinction among everything that isn't a Catholic.
Yeah.
Which is false on like I don't know how many levels that's false on. I want to kind of play with that and help our listeners understand more about the distinctions. The other reason I wanted to talk about it was we talk a lot about the historical church, and that's the one that arguably came through the apostles, was taken over by Constantine, became the Roman Catholic Church, and the Orthodox churches of the East kept going through those, branched out then into Lutheranism and Anglicanism and all of those things. So there's that historical church.
Mm-hmm.
And I would include in those all of the actual Protestant churches.
Yes.
And Mennonites I would include in that, even though we wouldn't necessarily call them Protestant church because they're different, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so they're all there. And then on the other side of this are churches, wherever they are, that didn't come up in protest to the historical church. They came up as local expressions of the Spirit or local communities gathering or local big egos deciding to plant something that honored them, whatever it was.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But they weren't concerned with righting the wrongs of a standard or civic or foundational church. They had a different goal.
Right, right.
Okay? So your classic church planter is not a Protestant because their goal isn't to take whatever was the historical church against which they're protesting and right the wrongs of that. They don't care.
They're not protesting anything.
Yeah, that's not their issue.
Yeah.
And the reason all of this matters is it's really hard to understand American church history without making that clear distinction.
Mm-hmm.
Because so much of what has come to be the evangelical church does not come out of Protestant movements.
Right.
And so to think of it as the Protestant church twists all kinds of things, including theology. And, you know, I hate when theology gets twisted.
Yeah.
So that's why you have that title.
Interesting. Okay. Well, we recently, you taught a course on church history, how we got here, mm-hmm. which I find incredibly fascinating. And I think that the course really did a great job of explaining how we got the variety, the massive variety of churches that we have in the United States today, how this splintered from that and that splintered from this. And so all that's really, really interesting. But the big dichotomy for me is the historical church that you discussed that's apostolic in nature, coming down directly from Peter through all
or,
saints.
Or at least that's the way it considers itself.
That's the way it considers itself. And then the revivalist church, which mm-hmm. is more like what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. These are churches or denominations that rose up out of spiritual movements, movements of the spirit, mm-hmm. in the best sense, mm-hmm. the churches mm-hmm. that were formed that way. So we have Methodism. We have...
Which is an interesting... It's kind of a weird one.
I'd love to talk about Methodism. Yeah. You have Presbyterianism. Mm-hmm. You mentioned Mennonites. You have Quakers. And then you have the largest group, which mm-hmm. is Baptists. Lots and lots of Baptists.
Mm-hmm.
So for the Baptists that are listening right now that are so confused... What makes a Baptist a Baptist, and why aren't they Protestant? Now, you've already sort of talked about what makes a Protestant Protestant.
Right.
But if they didn't come from a Protestant place, where did they come from?
Okay, so going back to the Anabaptists.
Yes.
Okay, which was a European movement. A lot of them moved here to this continent during the time that people were moving from Europe to take over land, right? Mm-hmm. So there is, in fact, the Anabaptist strain that is here, okay?
Mm. What is the modern expression of that?
I am willing to be corrected in this because this is not my strength of history, but I believe it's like the Mennonites, that
gotcha. Okay.
Group of people. But again, people, listeners, if you know better than that, please correct me.
Yeah, drop us a note.
That is not my area of expertise. So there are those. But I think understanding the movements in the United States pre-1980, mm-hmm. you really have to understand how big this land actually is.
Yeah.
And that for generations, if not a couple of hundred years, the historical churches that had taken root in the East and in the South, the Anglican Church, Presbyterian Church, Catholic Church, they didn't have enough ordained people who could administer the sacraments. So those ordained people, and John Wesley's most famous of these, right? But those ordained people would go from church to church to church, showing up in those churches a few times a year, maybe, mm-hmm. to do the sacraments, mm-hmm. to host the Eucharist or to baptize people, mm-hmm. or whatever. However, that sense of wanting to connect to, and this is at its best, right? Connect to worship God or to be in community existed whether or not there was an ordained person there.
Yeah.
Okay? And that's all fine and good. So what happened was over time, those local connections became stronger pieces. Mm-hmm. And particularly the Protestant churches, like what became Methodism, started ordaining local people. So John Wesley really didn't intend to stop being an Anglican, mm-hmm. right? Just like Luther didn't intend to stop being Catholic. Mm-hmm. But in the case of Wesley, and we can go into lots and lots of history on this, no point. At some point, he decided to ordain someone else on this continent. Once he decided to ordain someone, he had two choices. Either he had made himself a bishop of the Anglican Church, which would have been difficult because mm-hmm. you can't name yourself bishop of the Anglican Church, and yes, I am talking to you some post-evangelical Anglicans, because it misses the whole point.
Yeah.
Or you decide to do something different.
Yeah.
And that's fine. No condemnation. But it is a choice to move in a different way.
Right.
So once Wesley ordained somebody who then could ordain somebody who could ordain somebody, there was a shift in the character mm-hmm. of that group of churches.
Yeah, it became something else.
It became something else. Mm-hmm. Okay? So Methodism has its own kind of oddness in this. But that's the essential idea. So you had people who could administer the sacraments. And then you had lots and lots and lots of lay people. Well, over time, and probably not even over time, the Puritans would count as this in some ways, in some places, you had people who said, well, what's with this whole ordaining thing? I mean, what's that about?
Yeah.
Right? The community lifts up someone to be their leader, to be their pastoral type.
Yeah.
And in those cases, it wasn't so much about whether, necessarily, it wasn't so much about how they were educated or whether they'd been touched by some bishop somewhere. That wasn't the issue. The issue was, who can be our leader of these things? And then how you frame these things differs. But that's why in so many American traditions, including many, not all, many Baptist churches, there's no emphasis on, for example, seminary.
Mm-hmm.
Churches connect to each other through affiliation, not through denomination.
Right.
So there's no hierarchy that kind of owns the brand, if you will. Right.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's just got a different character because it starts as a local thing.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, one of the nice analogies of this, and it just shows you how deep these distinctions are, is it really is the difference between temple and synagogue in first century Judaism.
Ooh, okay.
Because the temple was organized and run by the priestly class that had been Aaron, so forth and so on and mm-hmm. so forth. But synagogues were local rabbis who taught and educated and connected people together. And so if you had a minyan, that is 12 men, in an area, you could have a synagogue, but you couldn't have a temple.
Ah, I see. Okay.
Right?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
So you couldn't get 12 people in Alabama
mm-hmm.
to create a Anglican cathedral, but they could start a church.
Okay.
That's kind of the distinction.
That makes a lot of sense.
Okay. When you realize that so much of the way Americans think of Christian church really doesn't have to do with the Catholic, Anglican, Orthodox, etc., really has to do with these little pockets of expression or these little communities that came together. Mm-hmm. And the thing that held them together was the fact they were all by themselves out in the middle of nowhere.
Right.
And some religious conviction of some kind.
Yeah.
That's what develops all these little pockets of faith structures.
Yeah, little faith communities.
Little faith communities. The reason Baptist is so perfect for this is, A, it's based on baptism, mm-hmm. and baptism can be done by anybody.
Yeah.
Leaving the theology aside
right.
for a second. But it's also based on this sense of soul freedom. That is, your soul connects with God and determines your faith, determines your beliefs, determines your blah, mm-hmm. blah, 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 blah.
Mm-hmm.
So in the best of the Baptist tradition, mm-hmm. to me, what I would call the best, there's a sense that you and I may believe quite differently because God is speaking to us differently,
mm-hmm.
but we can be in community together because we are both Baptists, if we were both Baptists.
That makes sense.
We both believe baptism is what matters.
Yeah, and having been a part of, I don't personally identify as Baptist, but I have been a part of two different Baptist churches that were very different, and yet there were these kinds of similarities you're talking about.
And please know, I mean, if you're listening to me and you're a church history scholar, please know that I understand that I'm skirting a lot of details here. But I'm trying to come up with just kind of a different way of thinking about this.
Yeah.
About whether you think of yourself as being part of a chain going back to Christ, or mm-hmm. at least to Peter.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you think of yourself as part of that chain, and in some churches, whether you think of the liturgy as reflecting what is going on forever and ever in the heavens, that's another piece of some historical, but not all historical churches, right? whether you think of yourself that way, whether you experience yourself as part of that, mm-hmm. or whether you experience yourself primarily as part of a local community or a separate being who happens to affiliate. And that's the difference that I really want to lift up here. If you are one of the latter, you're not protesting against something else. You're not trying to reform something else.
Right.
You're doing something that's either local or that's driven by your own history, your own convictions, your own affiliations, whatever that thing is.
Yeah.
There are different ways of being in the world in faith.
Definitely very, very different. And having experienced both, I definitely understand that they are different experiences. I mean, for me, very different experiences. I grew up in more of a revivalist church, mm-hmm. fundamentalist in theology and in doctrine, mm-hmm. sprung from the Methodism history. Mm-hmm. Honestly, there are bits of Methodism, or Wesleyanism is mm-hmm. probably a better way to put it, that do resonate with me. Mm-hmm. But then I find it so interesting to worship in a historical church because I feel like I'm a part of what's going on in the heavens, like you mentioned, like mm-hmm. something much larger. So it really is a difference between literally a historical church right. that goes all the way back to at least Peter mm-hmm. and a local church that functions as sort of like the social hub, the fellowship hub, the place where people who all love Jesus in some way can get together. I think about the church that my grandfather and my family in Alabama attend, and it's very much like that. It's the one church in their very tiny community, and you can't tell me that everybody in that community believes exactly the same thing, right. but they believe enough of the same thing,
right.
and they have this commonality of experience
yes.
that sort of pulls them all together, and it's where the cemetery is, it's where the baby showers right. happen, it's where the weddings happen. Where the funerals are, all that stuff happens in the context of this one little church.
That's right.
And they happen to be called Baptist, mm-hmm. but I don't think it would even matter if they were Methodist or something else.
Right. That's not what they're doing.
Because that's not what they're doing.
Yeah. Yeah. You also, in the churches that come out of what I think of as the revivalist tradition, that mm-hmm. is that homegrown kind yeah. of spirit moving, something happens. That's where you get your variety of music. That's
yeah.
where you get individual prayer or prayers of the people that are different from the next church over. Now, the advantage of that is it's personal. It feels mm-hmm. like that local church. Mm-hmm. The disadvantage is you have no connection.
Right.
So the idea of the entire universal eternal body of Christ is tough to get at mm-hmm. in those churches. Mm-hmm. It's hard to have mm-hmm. texture to that. The other real distinction that I see is, and again, gross generalization, but the notion of communion, marriage in some places, funerals in some places, but communion and baptism being sacraments, having a very specific texture that is otherworldly, mm-hmm. that's historical church stuff.
Right.
And the reason for that, going back far enough, is not that everybody said, no, it should not just be priests who can do this. It was, well, there aren't any priests. Mm-hmm. Again, so what you find is in those churches, the ones that are more locally based, the revivalist churches and so forth, is you find a sense that those things are remembrances or honors or drawing into the community. They have a different, again, different texture. They're about the community mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. about the community doing things together
right.
rather than
right.
here we are, when I take this bread, I am eating the same body as my grandfather and his grandmother and all the way back to all the way back.
Yeah, yeah.
Very different way of seeing the world and experiencing your faith.
Extremely different.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of the difference between worshiping as an I and worshiping as a we.
Say more about that. I'm not sure I agree, but I want to hear more about what you're thinking.
I think that in revivalist churches, in my experience, the emphasis is on the individual life, faith life, soul of the believer or the sinner, however you want to look at it. Whereas I believe that in the historical church, the experience is more collective. And it's more like we are joined together with angels, with other believers, past and present. And we are here together doing this thing. It feels different to me And I think that's part of why, like, many revivalist churches wouldn't connect with, like, what you're talking about with sacrament. Mm-hmm. Well, we take communion the first Sunday of every month. Mm-hmm. I mean, what's different about it?
Right.
See, but right. But it is different.
Right. I'd like to suggest a modification of what you just said.
Yeah, please.
I think the liturgy of the historical church emphasizes we, but the experience can be more individual. Mm-hmm. The liturgy of the revivalist church tends to emphasize I, but there's this sense that we are the church
right.
apart from others.
Right.
So there's an identity thing that's a little, I think the what counts as I and we is very different.
It's different. No, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah, I like that.
The other thing that may be useful to our listeners, or may not, and they can just chalk it up to more trivia, is that in the Roman church and the Orthodox church, and I'm naming those in those particular ways for a particular reason, the centerpiece of worship is Eucharist. It's not the sermon.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? The sermon is a revivalist thing,
mm-hmm.
and I would include Wesley in this, but generally it's a revivalist idea. Mm-hmm. The center is the sacrament. The idea there, and this is really important, mm-hmm. there is no church if the body of Christ is not present. What makes a church is the presence of the body of Christ. And what I mean by that is the bread, the, mm-hmm. you know, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That idea changes everything. And it doesn't translate to revivalist churches where the center of the church is the communion of believers.
Yeah, okay, I get that.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you can see that distinction mm-hmm. as kind of, again, gross generalization, but understanding that distinction between the sacrament being the center and the community being the center,
mm-hmm.
it explains everything
yeah.
about why those they don't translate well, even if you're trying to kind of come up with a good
right.
amalgam, like
right.
the UCC try, it doesn't work,
mm-hmm.
right? Because the center, what counts as your faith, what counts as your connection,
mm-hmm.
is so radically different.
Right, wow. I would love to hear from both Baptists and other non-Protestants who are categorized as Protestants. And I would love to hear from Episcopalians and Lutherans and Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
We would love to have your questions and any clarifications or any observations that you have. You can always reach out to us via email, Elaine, E-L-A-N-E, or Benton, B-E-N-T-O-N, at schoolforseekers.com. Also, we would love, 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 love for you to join our mailing list. Please go to our website, schoolforseekers.com, and do that. That's how you find out about the things we are doing.
Like classes and
yeah, and
events.
Live recordings and house concerts and all kinds of cool stuff coming up. So we want you to be in the know about all those things. So please sign up and share this podcast with your friends if you like what we're doing. We grow this audience because of you guys.
And I'm sorry, if you're still listening and you're a Presbyterian, I want to know whether you are actually as Calvinist as the Jehovah's Witnesses.
Ooh, now there's another episode. I like it. Season 4, I'm going to write that down. Thanks, you guys, for listening. Bye.
Bye.